Throughout the 3 years I've been making videos, I've talked about dual screen emulation quite a bit. How to make it work, why it's important, and what hardware you should use. But admittedly, I feel like I've skipped over one important topic throughout all these videos. How to take your single screen phone and play dual screen systems across two displays, instead of the cramped setup that is a typical single screen. So let's take this opportunity to dive into how to make it work on both Android and iOS, my experiences using either platform, and then some additional hardware recommendations to get the best experience. Chapters are provided in case you care about one platform over the other. But first, let's discuss some initial pain points. Primarily, when we're talking about multi-screen emulation on mobile platforms, I'm essentially talking solely about DS emulation. Unless you happen to have a phone or tablet with multiple screens, of course. On Android, 3DS emulation has been around for a while, and Wii U emulation is in its early developmental stages. Both work great with the right hardware, but neither has tools to selectively output only a single screen to a separate device. If you're interested in making those systems work with your mobile device, you're pretty much stuck streaming to that device from another computer. I created a full guide a while back showing how to make that work with Steam Link, and I'll have a link to it in the video description if you're interested. If you're not as concerned about wireless connections, of course, and have a modern iPad or Android device, you can also use a UVC app to simply use that device as an external display. It works extremely well in my experience, and allows me to play games as I would anywhere else. With all that in mind, this video is going to focus solely on DS emulation, running on either an Android or iOS device, and connecting to an external display. Okay, starting with Android, there's several ways to emulate DS games. The main three I swap between are Drastic, MelonDS, and Lemuroid. All three work great, with each having their own pros and cons, strengths and weaknesses. Unfortunately, as of this recording, only Drastic has the ability to output one of the DS's emulated displays to an external display. Fortunately, Drastic is also a really good, really versatile DS emulator, and would be my first recommendation to anyone looking to emulate DS games on Android. Setup is also extremely easy. After installing the app from the Play Store and pointing it toward your ROMs, select Change Options from the initial menu, then select Video and scroll all the way to the bottom, and you'll find three settings you'll want to validate. The first, External Display Mode. Select either Correct Aspect Ratio or Full Screen, depending on whether you want to preserve the aspect ratio of the DS top screen or stretch it to fit your external display. Number two, External Display Screen. This determines which display will output to that external display. I'd recommend selecting top screen, as that'll make sure the touchscreen stays on your phone. And then three, external display border. This is totally optional to play with. I really haven't changed it myself, but if you wanted to change the effective size of the output display, you can shrink or increase the border around that display here. With those settings in place, connect your device to a monitor, launch a game, and you should see it output correctly. Of course, if this is your first time launching Drastic, you might need some extra fiddling to make it look exactly like mine. Luckily, it's really easy to accomplish. First, select the menu icon, choose the menu option, scroll down, and then tap on the Select Screen Layout option. From here, choose Landscape Aspect, and then afterward, it should kick you back to your game. If it then shows you the top screen on your device instead of the bottom screen, don't fret. Just select the menu icon again and choose the option to swap displays. Next, if you don't have an external controller connected, you might want to adjust the position of the touch controls. For that, select the menu icon again, choose the menu option, and then select Edit Screen and Virtual Pad, followed by Landscape Aspect. On this screen, you can drag and drop the bottom screen wherever you feel comfortable. Then you can select Menu and Edit Controller Layout to drag and drop the touch controls to move them around however you wish. Meanwhile, the Resize button in the corner adjusts the scale of those buttons. Once finished, tap the Apply button and then select Menu and either save the setup as your default, global layout, or only for this current game. Alternatively, if you do have an external controller, you can update your mapping by going into the menu, selecting Options, and then External Controller. That menu should give you all of the options you need to map your controls appropriately. Then, once you're done and get back to your game, you can disable touch controls by selecting the X'd out controller in the quick menu. While I couldn't possibly test all Android devices, this method tends to work with all the devices in my collection, given that they have display out capabilities. Though for Samsung devices, I have needed to disable DeX to allow Drastic to work as intended in the past. Of course, just because I'm showing gameplay using a portable monitor doesn't mean you're limited to that option. Because this is a simple wired connection, it's extremely flexible. You could play games on your TV, through a laptop using a capture card, or even another phone or lightweight portable display. Using one of Mechanism's phone mounts and one of their adapters attached to a cheap case, I can easily mount one phone onto another and use the top phone as an external monitor using a short USB-C cable, Genki Shadowcast, and the USB Camera Pro app. The mounting's surprisingly solid and not too top heavy. It's a bit gimmicky, for sure, but something that might be worthwhile trying out if you have an Android smartphone from the past 6 years or so collecting dust in a drawer somewhere. Might also be good inspiration to try additional setups of your own using a similar idea. Once you've had fun with all that, you can also consider ditching the cables altogether. As long as you have a modern device and a monitor or TV that can receive a Chromecast signal, you can easily mirror your device's screen, which will still be treated as an external monitor by Drastic. Similarly, if you have a Samsung phone alongside a device that supports receiving a Miracast signal, you're able to use that in the exact same way. Though, if you prefer Chromecast for those devices, I've found that setting as a toggle by holding down Smart View on my Samsung phones. Just note that your experience will vary greatly depending on the quality of your internet connection. Poor connections may result in the connection being dropped, or there being a significant delay between input on your device and what's happening on the external display. In general, I'd say wireless connections are best used when wired connections aren't feasible, or when you're mainly looking to play slower-paced games. After all, you'll likely feel any delays less in Pokemon Black than you would in Sonic Rush. Basically, common sense is key, but yeah, that's really all there is to it on the Android side of things. Download Drastic, connect your device to an external display, either wired or wireless, update your settings to your likings, and then have fun. It's incredibly easy and honestly one of the best demonstrations of Android's flexibility as a gaming platform that I can think of. Now, let's move on to iOS, where the setup gets, well, slightly more complex, slightly less flexible. Like Android, there's only one easily available app at the moment that can emulate DS games and pass an extra display to an external display. That's Delta. To get started using external display with Delta, all you need to do is install the app, install the DS BIOS and firmware it requests, point it towards your games, and connect it to an external display. Like on Android, this can either be wired using a USB-C connection or wireless using AirPlay. The complexity here comes from the nature of Apple's hardware. For starters, if you'd like to use a wired connection, newer iPhones and iPads can handle that easily over a USB-C connection. However, if you're using an older, lightning-equipped device, you might need to source a special adapter or else, well, be out of luck. Similarly, AirPlay, well, at least for me, isn't the most common streaming standard. Miracast and Chromecast are either baked into many of my displays or can be added with a cheap dongle. The only device I have that supports AirPlay is the MacBook Pro I use for editing videos. Which is all to say that if you really want to use a wireless setup for this, you'll either need to hunt for a very specific display or buy more Apple products. Whether that's a downside for you will depend on your personal preference. For me, it feels like a bit of a headache. As are the controls, to be honest. If you're using an external controller whose input you can remap by tapping settings and selecting the player number you want to associate it with, everything is pretty much seamless. Immediately, you'll get only the bottom screen on your device with no touch controls in sight. It just works. Unfortunately, the same can't be said if you'd prefer to use touch controls. For whatever reason, Delta only comes with a single landscape layout for DS, with no in-app options to edit the virtual displays or touch input locations on the fly. As a result, the touch controls are a bit cramped and the bottom DS screen is shoved off to the side. It's not great. To fix this, you'll need to load a custom Delta skin. You'll either need to create one yourself using Delta's lengthy guide, or see if you can track someone down who's done the work for you. To save y'all time, I'll have a link in the video description to a bare-bones skin I created to fix this issue for myself on my 16 Pro Max. It was not a great experience, to be honest. Initially figuring out what to do felt cumbersome, and fine-tuning the layout felt tedious, at best. It's a bit of a bummer, to be honest. For dual-screen emulation apps, the ability to rearrange virtual displays and input is key to comfortable gameplay. Even with iPhones pretty much only having a single form factor, being forced into a single way to play a game isn't the right move. Hopefully, Delta will update in the future with better layout control. If so, expect an update in the form of a pinned comment down below. Fortunately, even with all this hassle, it's a decent experience playing DS games on an iPhone using Delta with an external display. Similar to the setups I described for Android phones, portable monitors and TVs are great, and nothing stopping you from connecting to a capture card to play on your laptop, or even bolt a second display to your device for a more portable handheld experience. Though that's not the only solid portable setup to consider here. The ability to seamlessly use my MacBook as an external wireless display using AirPlay feels great. As expected of Apple's synergy between their products, the connection is fast and a bit more solid than Chromecast, largely due to my MacBook Pro having better Wi-Fi support than my Chromecast with Google TV or Chromecast Ultra. While only being able to stream to my laptop feels a bit limiting, it is still a very handy setup. If I were someone who used an iPhone as his primary phone and took his MacBook everywhere, I could see this streaming setup being really convenient and portable. And, you know, quirks aside, once everything's set up, I don't really need to worry about changing much else in the settings. I have many points of friction with Delta, but it does work consistently well, which matters most in this case. If you're an iPhone user, especially one with other Apple products, giving this setup a shot seems more than worthwhile. So that's dual-screen DS emulation on both Android and iOS. On Android, DS emulation is hyper-customizable to your specific needs. Meanwhile, emulation on iOS looks maybe a bit more polished with nifty tricks up its sleeve. No matter what device you have, you're gonna be in for a good time. To close out this video, let's talk hardware recommendations. Starting with infrastructure, the devices I've used in this video to demonstrate external display use include a Genki Shadowcast, basically the smallest capture card I've ever seen, a USB-C powered Asus portable monitor, and a Chromecast. If these match exactly what you're looking for and your setup, check out the links in the video description. Now, for the actual emulation device, I find phones and small tablets to be ideal to use as the lower screen that I'm holding in my hand. iPads and larger Android tablets might be tempting to have more screen real estate, but DS games don't tend to scale the best to large screens already. Plus, for many games, the amount of movement needed for touch controls might not be best served on a display with a ton of travel distance. Essentially, for this setup, the phone you have in your pocket will typically be the best option. However, if you're the type of person looking to purchase new hardware specifically for DS emulation, I do have some extra recommendations. Firstly, stick to Android. It's an easier setup with more customization options and a more mature emulation community. If you're looking to spend a significant amount of time emulating DS games, it's just about the best platform to use at the moment. Secondly, try looking for a device with a display close to a 4:3 aspect ratio. Doing so will give you a properly sized lower display while playing your games. Admittedly, the options for those sorts of devices are a bit limited, but they're also easy to find. Newer Android-based emulation devices like the Retroid Pocket Mini, Amernic RG Cube, or iNeo Pocket DMG might be worth considering if you prefer an all-in-one device with decent touch displays. Just note that with those types of devices, the software experience may not be as polished as with large smartphone manufacturers. For a tablet experience, the Surface Duo 1 is always going to be my first recommendation. Not only are its two 4x3 displays great for playing DS games handheld by itself, but it also folds back flat to provide the perfect bottom screen for an external display. It also has full support for Surface Pens if you want more precise stylus action. The caveat with this one is that it's no longer receiving firmware updates, which is a bit of a bummer. But its version of Android 12 is also more than adequate for an emulation device. Meanwhile, for a smartphone, folding screen phones do great for these purposes. My Z Fold 4 has an internal display pretty close to 4x3, has stylus support, and offers a ton of room for a touchscreen while clipped into a controller. It's great, and I couldn't recommend it enough for someone dedicated to this type of gaming. Though, just note the crease down the middle alongside a more fragile display are ideal for games that require really intense touchscreen action, like Pokemon Ranger or The World Ends With You. Still, that's all kind of the benefit of going Android over iOS in this case. There are a ton of varied options to choose hardware that matches your specific needs without getting locked into the trade-offs of a specific device type. Beyond the emulation hardware, also consider investing in an external controller, if your device doesn't have built-in controls, of course. Controller clips, like those using Mechanism's phone mount, are especially great for iPhones if you don't care about holding the screen horizontally. They clip on easily to the back of popular controllers and are really easy to apply and remove. Alternatively, for a telescopic controller, I've been really happy with the GameSir G8 Plus lately. It's a Bluetooth controller that's extremely comfortable, fairly modular, and accommodates even my largest phones. It works great. There's even a USB-C model if you prefer a more direct connection. I only went Bluetooth because I have certain phones that couldn't connect with the USB-C model. Finally, if you're looking to use a wired connection and controller at the same time, I'd say either look for a controller that leaves a port exposed, has full pass-through USB-C support, or just look for angled adapters. I have a few right-angle USB-C adapters from previous projects that slide in easily between my phone and the edge of the G8 Plus. It's a bit wonky looking, for sure, but it's entirely functional. It also makes disconnecting a bit easier than if I used a USB-C cable with a right-angle termination. I'll leave links to all of those, a few controllers, Mechanism's phone mount, and whatever else I mentioned in this video, down in the description in case you're interested. While you're checking that out, also make sure to leave a comment if you have any additional questions about getting set up or want to share your own setup tips with others. I'm always looking for new ways to introduce folks to dual screen gaming and have loved the tips folks have provided me in the past. As always, if you found this video helpful or informative, also go ahead and give it a like to let me know, then get subscribed for more dual screen shenanigans in the near future. With the Surface Duo 2 reaching its end of support, I'm in the process of writing a postmortem to document what it's like to use in the moment and what folks should expect if they want to pick one up in the future. That's going to be all for this video though. I hope this video's given y'all tons of new ideas about dual screen gaming, but until next time, catch you later.